So now we proceed with the second speaker. This is Dr. Charlotte Suetta from Copenhagen, and she will present topic on the effect of short-term disuse and subsequent retraining on molecular signaling and muscle sites in old versus young adults. Please, Charlotte.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniela. And I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to participate in this symposium, and also thank the organizers for the opportunity to share some of our data on this very important topic with you. So, the topic of my talk will be focusing on skeletal muscle atrophy as a consequence of disuse, as well as skeletal muscle regrowth as a consequence of retraining, and maybe more importantly, how these two situations are affected by aging. So, we all know that with aging, we lose muscle strength and muscle mass. And I think it's fair to say that we also know a lot about what happens if you put young individuals to bed rest or post-unloading or disuse to them and subsequent retraining. But our knowledge about adaptations to unloading and retraining in older individuals is fairly unknown. And that's despite the fact that older individuals are much more prone to periods of hospitalization and bed rest and disease. So it's important that we gain more knowledge about what happens to older individuals in this situation. And why is skeletal muscle so important? Apart from accounting for about 40% of our total body mass, it's also very important to keep our metabolic function, and it acts as a very important reservoir in catabolic conditions. But most importantly, low muscle mass markedly increases the risk of frailty, morbidity, and even mortality. So if we take a look at the animal model, it's been shown that if we pose animals, rodents, to unloading, the data are a little inconsistent, but the majority of studies actually find that young individuals, the young animals, lose more muscle mass than the older individuals, or the older animals, of course. But if we look at the subsequent muscle regrowth, the data are more consistent, and then we find that young animals have a much larger capability to regain the loss of muscle strength and muscle mass than the older animals. So less muscle atrophy, but even less potential to muscle regrowth in the older animals. So to try to get a little closer to the adaptations in human individuals, we decided some years ago to look at how 2 weeks of immobility would affect healthy young individuals compared to healthy older individuals. And we control for the activity level, because you all know probably that activity is affecting muscle mass just as much as aging per se. So it's very important to control for the activity level. And these older individuals that volunteered to this study were actually quite active, just as active as the younger counterparts. So they were posed to 2 weeks of one leg casting and 4 weeks of resistance exercise 3 times per week afterwards. What we did see was, when we looked at what happens to the maximal muscle strength, we could, from the beginning, we could see that although they were equal in the activity level, at the inclusion, the older ones were markedly weaker before the immobilization. And what we also saw was that both young and older individuals actually lost quite a lot of muscle strength due to immobilization, but regained it with 4 weeks of resistance exercise. When we looked at what happened with the muscle mass, We looked at both anatomical cross-sectional area with CT scan, MR scans, and also assessed all, cordyceps volume. And what we did see was quite interesting because, as you can see here, older individuals actually lost almost the double of the muscle mass compared to the young, older individuals, but they were able to regain the muscle mass after 4 weeks of resistance training compared to the older individuals. Despite 3 times per week, 4 weeks of resistance training, they weren't able to regain the loss of muscle mass. So if we first take a look at what is driving or try to sneak into the mechanisms, what is actually explaining this difference, we looked into the literature of what is underlying skeletal muscle atrophy in the animal models. And there's a lot of potential very important pathways driving these this atrophy. And we assessed all the different markers you can see named here. But in the animal model, we know that proteolysis is the most important signaling pathway driving muscle atrophy. And Jennifer Sacek from the Goldberg group has also very elegantly demonstrated that not only is these atrogenes very important, but there's also a certain time course. As you can see here, it seems to be regulated in the very initial phase of unloading in the animal model. And if we look at the two-week time point here, both atrogenes are actually down to baseline levels. So very inspired by this paper, we decided to add another immobilization study to be able to look at this time course in human individuals as well. So we included 2 new groups of healthy, young and old individuals. They were subjected to 4 days of immobilization only and 6 days of reloading. And then instead of the cast, we used a Donjoy brace. So we could, you know, just open the brace, take the biopsies after 1 day, 2 days and 4 days of immobilization without removing the brace to keep the muscle as immobilized as possible. And in that way, we could actually mimic the time course as we saw in the Sacek paper. And what we did see was when we looked at muscle strength, see, after only 4 days of immobilization, both groups actually had a decrease of about more than 10% in muscle strength. This is isometric muscle strength. And a little further decrease after 14 days of immobilization. So the vast decrease within the first days of immobilization. Important because most people are only hospitalized or confined to bed rest less than a week, but that also has a huge effect on muscle strength. So when we looked at what happens to the myofiber area, we saw that both groups, both old and young individuals, actually had a significant decrease in myofiber area within only 4 days of immobilization. And like the whole muscle measurements, here we saw that the older individuals actually had a much larger loss in at the 14-day time point compared to the older individuals. As I said, we assessed a lot of signaling markers, but the most interesting, if we just look at what could explain the age-specific regulation of the loss in muscle mass, was actually the proteolytic pathway with MRF and atrogen and then the ACT, and I will show you the results on that. If we first take a look at atrogen and MRF, you can see here that both old and young had an early increase in the expression levels of both MRF and atrogen, and but only the older individuals were downregulated at the 14-day time point. Moreover, we saw an age-specific decrease in phosphorylated ACT after only 2 and 4 days of immobility in mainly young individuals, which is actually under very much in line with most of the human studies demonstrating huge decreases in protein synthesis with immobilization in younger individuals. But this is not the fact with the older individuals in this case. Also supporting the results on muscle mass. So to conclude on this atrophy, in the initial phase of disuse, we see a rapid loss in muscle strength and muscle mass, along with an early increase in ubiquitin proteasome pathway and a downregulation of the oxidative metabolism in both young and old. And then in the later phase, age muscles selectively showed a decrease in atrogen and MRF expression and an elevated AC phosphorylation and a less marked atrophy response. If we take a look into the mechanisms trying to explain what is going on as a consequence of retraining, when we looked at the fiber types, 1 and 2, we saw marked increases in the young individuals with no increases in myofiber area in type 1 and 2 in old individuals. So how is this regulated? What can explain this difference? To look at that, we have to look at the satellite cells because we know they are essential for the capacity of muscle hypertrophy and regrowth. So in collaboration with Abigail Mackay, that is giving her presentation in one of the parallel rooms right now, we stained for satellite cells selectively in type 1 and type 2 fibers, and what we saw was that in contrast to the older individuals, only the young were able to upregulate the number of satellite cells, especially in type 2 fibers. Well, explaining much of the difference between the young and older individuals. We also saw correlation between myofiber area and the changes in number of satellite cells, both in collapsed myofiber area, but also for type 1 and type 2 fiber area. As I said, we also tried to look at some of the gene expression levels that could explain, but we didn't see any age-related differences between any of the signaling factors normally known to promote skeletal muscle atrophy. However, we did see that myostatin was regulated in a very age-specific way with an increased expression level with immobilization in old only, and then a less marked decrease with the start of retraining also in the old individuals. See here, a marked decrease in the expression level of myostatin in young only with retraining. So one question is, of course, is it the satellite cells that are old, or could it be other factors that are controlling this decrease in the possibility to proliferate? And Irina Conboy published this very elegant paper back in 2005, where she showed that there are systemic blood factors that play a role for the impaired satellite cell activation in old mice. She did that by combining the vascular system of an old and a young mice, and afterwards they isolated the satellite cells, and what they did see was that the aged cells that were having blood from a young animal had the same ability to proliferate as the young cells from the young animals. It is quite difficult to make human individuals volunteer for such a study, but a way we came over that was that we, at a meeting in Copenhagen, we took biopsies not from the participants, but from healthy older adults, and the Conboy group actually isolated the satellite cells from these individuals, and we took blood from either young or the old individuals, and did quite the same experiment, just with the plating the cells, and then let them grow in either young serum, the young cells, or in old serum. And what we see, quite mimicking the animal data, was that if you put old cells in, try to culture them in their own serum, they actually don't proliferate as well as if they get serum from a young individual. We also let them have a look at our biopsies from the immobilization study, and they also saw a diminished proliferation of the satellite cells in the old individuals. And also an attenuated response both in notch and delta in the older individuals only, indicating less potential for activation of the satellite cells. So not only don't they proliferate, but they don't activate as much as the younger individuals. They also demonstrated that the older human muscle fibers had higher levels of TGF-beta than the young individuals. So to conclude from this regrowth, human skeletal muscle regrowth is, I think, affected by aging. There's an impaired ability to recover from disused muscle atrophy, partly explained by a diminished myogenic cell expansion and activation, but also a reduced downregulation of myostatin, and of course also factors in the bloodstream, in the systemic environment, maybe TGF-beta or SMAD3. Thank you.